Hare Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Tinamine Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvisesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarane Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadhadhara Srivasadi Gaurabhakta Brinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare I thank you everyone for giving me an opportunity to glorify Srimad Bhagavatam and it's indeed nice to be back with you all. I still remember it was a very nice association we had the last time I was here. So I'm thankful that yes, another opportunity has been provided. Well, today the topic is that we'll be discussing about the glories of Srimad Bhagavatam. Hare Krishna, it's okay? Yeah, sorry. So today we'll be discussing about the glories of Srimad Bhagavatam. And the glories of Srimad Bhagavatam can be discussed in three strands, three ways it can be discussed. One is the structural perspective of Srimad Bhagavatam, that is about the way the contents have been structured, its poetic quality, etc., etc. The second one is about the spiritual perspective, that is what Bhagavatam has to say about itself, about its glories, straight from Bhagavatam. And the third one is what Jiva Goswami specifies or tells or elaborates in his Sandarbhas. That is, he gives the essence of Srimad Bhagavatam and who the main speaker of Bhagavatam is about whom are we speaking. That is, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Of course, of the three strands, we'll be just taking the first one, that is the structural perspective for today. And if you all give me an opportunity, the next class could be on the spiritual content. So the content structure, that is the structural perspective of Srimad Bhagavatam, would give you a more of a general sense of what makes the Srimad Bhagavatam a great work of literature. And that too on different levels. We'll see those levels today. Why our claim that Srimad Bhagavatam is the highest of scriptures and looking at it generally as a text, as a work of literature, scripture, that is its basic structure. So as I mentioned before, the spiritual content and the Jiva Goswami's thing are subjects which we'll address later on in further classes. So today's class will be more of from a broader perspective, descriptive of the Srimad Bhagavatam's place in literature, looking at it as a work of literature, scripture, and other perspectives would be more focused. This is today is more general. Actually, if you take any of these perspectives, everything is rasa, because it is mentioned Pibata Bhagavatam Rasamale. It's an order from Sukadeva Goswami. Pibata Bhagavatam, I mean, it is juice. So any perspective we take is rasa. So, now looking at it from an academic perspective, from the Srimad Bhagavatam itself, we hear about its own glories, but today we'll take a step back. And we'll look at it from the position of an academic or a secular perspective, as to what this work is. So this would give us a general sense of why, like Mahaprabhu says, it is Amala Puran. It is the highest of scripture. And this would enable us to appreciate how great Srimad Bhagavatam is. Actually, Srimad Bhagavatam itself describes about itself. But even if we examine it from a secular or an academic perspective, we'll see as to how great Srimad Bhagavatam is. In Srimad Bhagavatam, we have something which is quite extraordinary, something unparalleled. It's such a powerful and a beautiful piece of work that what we have been given to study is not at all laborious work. It is the highest gift which mankind can receive. And Bhagavatam itself makes mention of this point right at the end, that it is the highest gift which one can receive. And we need to be conscious of this, especially because what happens is, quite often we would have heard classes in the temple, classes given by senior acharyas, etc., glorifying Srimad Bhagavatam. But what happens is that we hear about it so often that it becomes routinized. Now, in fact, I got this book yesterday and I was surprised that Mahatma Prabhu has given this, from the head to the heart, and I will read from this about this point about we taking it for granted, you know, it being routinized. The lack of congruity between the teachings of Shastra and our lives is a problem we all encounter. How does this happen? One way is that this knowledge remains in our head without touching our hearts. That is the problem. We often say, I know that. But when we really don't. Yes, we know about it, but knowing it means living it. When we truly know something, our behavior changes. So this is what we need to address today. So as I mentioned, today's discussion would be more from a structural perspective, how the Bhagavatam is made up. Yes, I'm sorry. Yes, we could all go through this and then, yes. Now, Bhagavatam, in that body of Vedic literature, Vedas and Vedic literature in a general sense, Bhagavatam is that part of Puranas. It is forming a part of the Puranas. Puranas means, as everybody who would know Hindi, means old, ancient. So it describes stories about the Lord and his activities and incarnations, kings and great leaders of the world, and people who have shaped mankind like Manus. Now we'll see how the Puranas are stacked up, how they are written up. Puranas generally are a haphazard collection of stories and ideas. There could be repetitions, there will be digressions, and it could leave a general feeling of being disorganized as conversations move from one point to another. Secondly, Puranas generally are very large. Like, for instance, if you take the Skanda Purana and Vishnu Purana, they are so large that supposing if you have a verse and you don't know where it comes from, it will come in all probability from one of these two Puranas. They are so large. They encompass quite a huge space. Now, Srimad Bhagavatam is, however, although a part of the Puranas, is not structured like the other Puranas, which I said that it is haphazard, it is not disorganized, it is not haphazard, it is not redundant in the way it presents its ideas. And it is one of the most tightly composed works of Sanskrit literature, particularly of scripture that we can find. So we'll see how this is set up. The way Bhagavatam, unlike the other Puranas, the way Bhagavatam is written up, any doctorates here? PhD, doctorate, anybody? Well, generally, yes, Haribol. You may be knowing how we present a doctorate thesis. There will be an introduction, there will be a conclusion, there will be arguments, questions raised, answered, supported by philosophical arguments. This is how Bhagavatam is structured. Puranas don't have this kind of structure. And theologically, it is very, very systematic. Quite often you'll find Puranas, they will have Shaivite emphasis in a certain section. In another section, you'll have Vaishnavite emphasis. Another section, you'll find Tantric emphasis. And you'll find various kinds of emphasis. Bhagavatam is not like that. Bhagavatam has just one thread which runs throughout. It is consistent, and we'll see how. Okay, I forgot to mention one point, is that today we'll also be, since this is a scholarly pursuit, which what we are discussing today, we'd also be looking at viewpoints from scholars. Mind you, they are not devotees. They are scholars, but they have studied Srimad Bhagavatam quite passionately. I mean, they have studied in depth, and we'll be surprised to what is it that they have to offer us. Now, why do we have to take these scholarly inputs? I mean, we are in a devotional environment. We may be wondering, why do we want to take a scholarly input? I'll give you an example. Supposing if we have, say, a Janmashtami program or a New Year program or whatever, any program where quite a lot of people congregate. They come to this temple. And suddenly, one person, he goes up to Narahari Chaitanya Prabhu. Narahari Chaitanya Prabhu has not seen him before. He knows the devotees. Prabhu knows all the devotees here. That Prabhu, he goes up to Narahari Chaitanya Prabhu and says, Prabhuji, do you know that Prabhu who is serving in this temple? He is very, very good. Now, this external validation, Prabhu must be knowing that, yes, all these people, they are serving their hearts out. But when an external validation comes, it stays in the heart. That yes, there is something to this.
So that is the reason why we'll see external validations from scholars of Srimad Bhagavatam, what they have to say about it. And we'll come to this first one. There is a scholar in the West, and these scholars, yeah, mostly they were in the West. His name was Daniel Sheridan. He has studied Srimad Bhagavatam, not from the perspective of a devotee, but from the perspective of a scholar. And initially what he starts to say will be a little shocking, but just hold your thoughts, look at the complete emphasis of what he is trying to convey. Now I'm reading from his book. The book explains that the Bhagavata Purana has a viewpoint that is Advaita, that is non-dualistic. This is that scholar's interpretation. But then he goes on to add, but at the same time emphasizing the difference between God and the living entity. What does this mean? Sorry? That's it. Now see, he has caught on. He is a scholar. He is by no means a devotee. But the fellow has caught on. So this is why we need to, and this is the point which the Bhagavatam, I mean, gives out this emphasis from the beginning to the end. There is a difference between the Supreme Personality of Godhead and the devotees. Next, we'll study about language and grammar employed in Srimad Bhagavatam. For a moment, just presume. For a moment, just think. Can I have a copy of Bhagavatam? Any canto will do. Thank you, Prabhuji. Any thing, you have the Sanskrit sloka, and then you have that translated into English or whatever is the language of the book we are holding, and then we have the word for word meaning, then you have the translation, and then you have the purport. So when we are discussing this, assuming that we have Bhagavatam with us, apart from the Sanskrit slokas, we don't have anything else which has been given by Prabhupada. Because I want everyone to appreciate what Prabhupada has given us and how we should reciprocate. So for a moment, just presume that we don't have it. That is Prabhupada's Bhaktivedanta purport. As far as Sanskrit, those verses are all in Sanskrit. As far as the Sanskrit employed in the Bhagavatam verses are concerned, they are pretty difficult Sanskrit. On the other hand, if you compare it with, say, Puranas, they will be easy Sanskrit. The difference is, Bhagavatam has Vedic Sanskrit, whereas Ramayana, Mahabharata, Bhagavad Gita, and all the other Puranas, apart from Bhagavatam, they are written in classical Sanskrit. Classical Sanskrit is something you study for, say, about 2 years, 3 years, etc. You'd be able to compose verses in Sanskrit yourself. Vedic Sanskrit is a different ballgame altogether. After doing this 2 or 3 years of classical Sanskrit study, you would have to put in another year or two of Vedic Sanskrit to be able to read and compose. For instance, say suppose somebody is studying Sanskrit. The teacher could give him the Puranas, Ramayana, Mahabharata, etc. And he'd be able to understand. Even without the purports, it will be easy to understand. When it comes to Bhagavatam, it is different. Prabhupada makes a point here. He says, Vidya Bhagavatavadhi. Vidya Bhagavatavadhi means the limit of one's learning, avadhi, of Vidya is Bhagavata. That is Sanskrit learning, is to be able to read and understand the slokas. That is the limit. So while the other Puranas, Mahabharata, Ramayana, etc. are easy Sanskrit, Bhagavatam is in a class of its own. So it will have tongue twisters. Even if the verse is small, it will have tongue twisters. It's not easy. Bhagavad Gita, Ramayana, etc. is relatively easy. Now, particularly in connection with vocabulary employed in the Bhagavatam verses, you would find verses, the same word may be used in classical Sanskrit also, but the way Bhagavatam uses it, if you use that meaning here, this meaning which you are deriving from that sloka will go in a totally a different direction. You won't get the meaning. Now, supposing, as I mentioned, we do not have the Prabhupada purports, Bhaktivedanta purports, okay? We are reading a sloka and we are generally familiar with Sanskrit. We go to the Sanskrit dictionary. The Sanskrit dictionary The commonly used Sanskrit dictionary is a dictionary written by a German called Munia Williams. So you've come across, Germans are very good in Sanskrit, incidentally. You come across a word and you go to the dictionary to see what its meaning is. And it could happen that the meaning given in that dictionary refers to that very same sloka you are looking to translate and understand. That is, it is not used anywhere else. Now, how does Munia Williams know that? That meaning, he gives the meaning. Generally, with the meanings which he gives, Munia Williams is a very standard dictionary as far as Sanskrit to English is concerned. How does he know it? Any guesses? Sorry? The commentaries to the Bhagavatam. He reads the commentaries as to how various acharyas have interpreted this way, and he says this is how it is to be understood. Now, when Prabhupada tells us, please hear Bhagavatam from an person in coming in disciplic succession, it emphasizes this point. That yes, we need to understand Bhagavatam. This is not any other mundane literature. We need to understand Bhagavatam from someone who's coming in our parampara. Otherwise, the meaning would be totally going in a tangent. So this reinforces that point. So as I mentioned, Bhagavatam uses words which are not found in any other Sanskrit literature. So this aspect reinforces the point that why we should hear Srimad Bhagavatam from someone who's coming in disciplic succession. Now, it also uses archaic Sanskrit words. So not only does it use pretty tough language, but it uses archaic Sanskrit words. Now, the first verse of Srimad Bhagavatam, Janmadi Yasya Yataha, the last three words in that sloka is Satyam Param Dhimahi. Now, this word Dhimahi, where does it come from? Gayatri Mantra, correct. Where does the Gayatri Mantra come from? Yes? Which Veda? Correct. Now, who has studied the Vedas? Vedas is archaic Sanskrit, which we saw. Hardly anybody studies the Vedas. And Vedas is pronunciation based. You saw what happened in Vritrasura's case. I mean, he wanted a demon to kill Indra. Exactly the opposite happened because the pronunciation went for a toss. When it comes to Vedas, we got to be careful. So, Bhagavatam uses these kind of archaic languages. Now, I'll tell you a personal example which I witnessed firsthand. I was brought up in Calcutta, right from my childhood days. And we have this annual ritual of Avani Avattam. That is, we change the sacred thread. And in Calcutta, there was a sort of a philosophical place called Veda Bhavan. It was set up by Shankaracharya of Kanjipuram. So I knew that place from a childhood, and that happens to be exactly opposite our ISKCON guest house. So about 3 months back, I was staying in the guest house with my wife in the evening. We had a few rounds to complete. We were in the dawn. And then suddenly I saw, because that Veda Bhavan is exactly opposite the ISKCON guest house. I said, okay, come on. We've not been there for a long while. My wife has also been brought up in Calcutta. So we knew Veda Bhavan. We went there. And Sita Ram, Lakshman, Hanuman deities were there. We paid our obeisances. We sat down. We were doing chanting. There was a Panditji. I knew that Panditji. He was reciting Srimad Bhagavatam. And the book which he had must have had about 300 pages. It looked to be the entire Bhagavatam. It did not have word for word. It did not have translation. It did not have purport. Nothing. And he was struggling. And after half an hour, he finished the reading and he turned to me and told in Tamil, Palla Vadakkarathu. Means it's breaking my teeth. This is it. Now can we see how much Prabhupada has done for all of us? So that's why I said, you take out, forget for a moment that yes, Prabhupada has done anything. If not for Prabhupada, we wouldn't have gone even near, 1 mile near a Bhagavatam book. If not, of course, there is no way we can repay Prabhupada. But at least to make him feel happy, he has instituted this program of Srimad Bhagavatam class in all the temples worldwide. So the least we could do is to come and hear, relish and apply the Bhagavatam in our day-to-day living to the extent possible and spread the message. That is when Srila Prabhupada will be happy. And we won't come like that Panditji. Incidentally, when I explained to him, look, in ISKCON, this is how we have, you won't believe it. Fellow started jumping. Where can I get this book? Where can I get this book? And he wanted only in Tamil, sitting in Calcutta. So it took me about 2 months to organize that book from Chennai. I mean, just 2 days back, he got it. And he was thrilled that this is the kind of a depth you people are addressing. Whereas all he had was a 330 pages book with only Sanskrit slokas. You cannot understand what is written in that. Unless you are well versed. So we go to the next point. Yes, one more point is that there is a person called Biswas. I don't know his first name. He has written a book called A Linguistic Study of Bhagavatam. And what he does is as thick as the first canto. And what he does is, he goes through all the 12 cantos. Wherever you have difficult Sanskrit words, he gives what is the meaning. And practically, every page of that book, Srimad Bhagavatam, you will find references in his book giving the meanings. It is just like a dictionary. So, up to now, what is the image which we get is that it is a very tight structure. Theologically, it is very, very coherent, consistent, unusually difficult vocabulary and grammar. So what, again, for a moment think we do not have the Bhaktivedanta purports. The idea we will be getting when we are given this book to study, oh, it's a very boring book. Yeah, Hamsini Yoga. I won't be able to crack this. But then, Bhagavatam introduces one more aspect. We've seen this theologically, how it is coherent. Yes. This aspect is called poetry. It is one of the finest pieces of poetic literature in the world. And why is it so? Like, for instance, one scholar in University of Chicago, Daniel Ingels. He's a well-known and respected Sanskritist from the University of Chicago. He says, Srimad Bhagavatam remains, despite all what we saw, difficult Sanskrit and all of that, it remains as one of the most beautiful poems the world has ever seen. It is said by the Srila, Daniel Ingels. He is clearly in love with the Bhagavatam. Now, he is not a person like us, that we look at Bhagavatam as a book which will reform our lives. He is only studying it from an academic perspective, but he is clearly in love with Bhagavatam. And then, what are the variety of meters which are present in the Bhagavatam? We are all familiar with this Anushtubh meter. The whole of Bhagavatam, Mahabharata, and the Puranas, etc., are written in the easy to recite Anushtubh meter. Occasionally in Bhagavad Gita, you will find Trishtub being employed. That is, Anushtub is 8 per line, 8 words per line, and Trishtub is 11 or 12 words. Now, Bhagavad Gita does it in a certain fashion. Like you start the car is neutral. Turn the ignition, put on the first gear, Anushtub meter. Road is empty, second gear, Trishtub. So, because the road is empty, you are able to drive at a better speed, you are changing the gear to second. Similarly, Bhagavatam employs this strategy. Like, for instance, the entire first chapter, Arjuna is speaking to Krishna in the Anushtubh meter. Come second chapter, and he has that final moment of breakdown, then karpanya dosa mahatasva bhava, that it becomes big. So I mean, you can see where in Bhagavad Gita the thristup meter is employed. You will see the change of meter also. That is, there is a change in the recitation, the drift. So it indicates a mood change in Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavatam does not do anything like that. And Bhagavatam is totally different from all the other Puranas as far as meters go. Right from the first verse, Janmadi Yasya Yataha. It's a very long meter.
Janmadyasya yatanvayaditarato charthi svabhigna svara tene brahma hridayata adikavayo mohyanti yat suraya.
That is not the end of the verse. It is just two lines. It's so long and it's pretty difficult to recite Bhagavatam. Bhagavatam does not give any credence to mood changes, etc. It has its own strategy. So you will now say, okay, Anushtub I know, Thristub I know, I've got this meter. Incidentally, this meter is called Shardula Vikriditam. The translation in English is the play of the tiger. I mean, if you see, the beat is pretty definitive.
Janmadyasya yatanvayoditarata.
I mean, it's had a very definitive beat. In fact, you can dance towards it. And it shows that there is some heavy personality who is reciting this. Like the play of the tiger. That's why it's called the play of the tiger. It's not like some small bird flitting around here and there. No, it's heavy. You go to the third verse. You are familiar with 3 meters up to now.
Nigama kalpataro galitam phalam.
You cannot employ any of these meters. It changes. It will keep doing this again and again and again. Especially if you come to 10th canto. In Mayapur, we are reading 10th canto now. I mean, the variety of meters there is phenomenal. And the Bhagavatam will keep on doing this. Especially, you see the Gopi Gita.
Tava kathamritam tapta jivanam kaviriditam kalmasabaham.
Now, who sings this very nicely? I mean, I have my personal favorite. Bhakti Charu Maharaj. I mean, you should hear this from him. It's really wonderful the way he sings this particular sloka, the Gopi Geet. Now the scholars, when they see the Gopi Geet, they go into ecstasy because of the melody. Actually, it's the meaning which is ecstatic, but these people are enamored by the melody itself. Now, this melody is called Rajahamsi. Means a regal swan. I mean, if you see a swan swimming, how does it swim? It goes this way and then it goes this way and then it goes that way, all the while it is moving forward. You see this thing.
Tava kathamritam tapta jivanam kavibhiritam kalmasamaham shravana mangalam srimadatam bhuvignantiye bhuridajana.
See, the meter goes like this and like this and like this. So that's why it's called Rajahamsi. So Bhagavatam employs a variety of meters. And scholars They are enamored by these meters, whereas it's the meaning which is much more relishable. The other aspect about Bhagavatam is the layers of meaning which are embedded and which will take a person like Vishnu Chakri Thakur or Baladev Vidya Bhushan or Srila Prabhupada, etc., these great acharyas. It is only they who can spot that, yes, these are the meanings which are embedded in the Bhagavatam. Sridhar Swami, I'm sure all of you all have heard of him. He was starting to give the commentary on the first verse of Srimad Bhagavatam, Janmadi Yasya Yata. And there he says that, oh, where is that ocean of Srimad Bhagavatam so full and meaning? And where am I so dull-witted and slow-minded? How can an amoeba like me swim in this great ocean of Srimad Bhagavatam? He is comparing himself to an amoeba. Whereas Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had told the Goswamis, especially Rupan Sanatan, look, Sridhar Swami has given the commentary on Bhagavatam. Now you dare not fiddle around with it. I mean, that is etched in stone. Sridhar Swami's commentary. This is made by none other than Mahaprabhu. Whereas he is saying that, look, I am an amoeba. And yet he says there is hope. Just like the Lord lifted the mountain Mandara, which was sinking into the ocean, by holding it up onto his back, in the same way I pray that he may lift my understanding so that I can do something worthwhile from Srimad Bhagavatam and churn its meaning so that I may be able to extract all the valuable gems which are embedded in them. Like when the Milky Ocean was churned, quite a lot of things came. And it took an expert, like the Supreme Personality of Godhead, to be able to facilitate that. So here again, Srimad Bhagavatam is by no means an easy thing. So if anybody has said, I have read Srimad Bhagavatam, you can take it that yes, he has not even started. Because he wouldn't have been able to understand it. I mean, so much is embedded. Like for instance, this Jay and Vijay pastime. And the four Kumaras come there. They curse Jay and Vijay. They say, you are seeing differences in Vaikuntha, in a place where there is no scope for seeing differences. You are seeing differences of caste and creed and family and this and that. It is not done. Why? Because we are all born from the same mother. They are referring to Krishna, of course. Now, and then he is talking about we are born from the same womb. All coming, Krishna is the seed-giving father. So, if you translate literally, you may not be able to appreciate exactly what is there. But that is the reason why we need to take the help of senior acharyas. Similarly, the first verse of Bhagavatam, Janmadi Yasya Yata. Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, he gave a class, how long, Prabhu?
3 months.
Now, if he was to give a class on just that one verse for 3 months, what is the amount of content in that one verse? And it takes a personality like Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur to extract all of that and give it to us. So that is Bhagavatam. And all the senior acharya, Jiva Goswami, Vishnu Chakri Thakur, each of them have written 4 or 5 different commentaries on just the first verse. In fact, I heard somewhere that Srimad Bhagavatam is the only literature which has about 90 different commentaries given by Acharya, of which now we have access to only about 30 or 35. And the next competitor in the number of commentaries is the Vishnu Puran, which has 5 commentaries. This is Bhagavatam. So, up to now we have had tightly composed literature, philosophically consistent arguments, difficult vocabulary and grammar, highly poetic, with embedded meanings. Now we come to this. This will be the last manuscript history. Now, this is a topic, manuscript history, which normally in our lives we may not have to contend with. But it's useful to know that. And to tell you frankly, when I was doing all of this, this is the part which I relished maximum. The others were more like a class teacher teaching all the students, giving all the formula and we are seeing. This one, not only can we have an interactive session, but it's pretty, I found it interesting. I don't know how you all will. We have this Bhagavatam, right? You open and we see these slokas. Where did these slokas come from? These slokas which Prabhupada has used, they must have come from somebody, somewhere. Yes. Actually, I also do not know the definitive answer to this, and it's not necessary, because we will get the drift of this argument by taking guesses. We could be, say, Gaudiya Math, like the first canto, I think so, was published mid-65, Prabhu? Mid-65. Prior to that, it could have been the Gaudiya Math or Gita Press. Now, those Gaudiya Math Bhagavatam verses, where did they come from? Where are they getting the text? Maybe early printed manuscripts. Now, before that, those early printed manuscripts, before that, somebody must have written. Before that, could have been handwritten copies of Bhagavatam on paper. Actually, towards the end of Jiva Goswami's tenure itself, we had the early versions of paper. And before that, it would have been palm leaves, birch, etc. Now, what is happening is, from one format, it is getting copied onto another format. And mind you, we do not have this wonderful instrument called laptop. Control C, Control V, we are done. We don't have that. So, you have to look like this and write like this. You have to look like this, write like this. And we are not talking of 700 slokas of Bhagavad Gita alone. We are talking of 1 lakh verses in Mahabharata, 18,000 verses in Bhagavatam. You think that's an easy job? I'll tell you one embarrassing story which happened to me. 1993, I went to Dubai. And I landed in the office and that place, I don't know whether you all know, anybody from the Middle East here? He'll understand the concept. Yes, Mataji. That place floats on a concept called post-dated checks. That is, you issue checks for 20, 30, 40 years into the future. And the day I landed, we had taken a school for 35 years and we had to give post-dated checks, one per quarter, that is four per annum for 35 years into the future. And the person who has to do that, he was on leave. So my boss said, tum karo. So I did. I had to write up about, it's just, only thing is those names, Muhammad bin Salam al-Salaiki. I mean, they are long names. Then you have to put the date and the amount, words and figures, and account pay. That's all. Signature, my boss will do. I had to write about 150 checks. I made 35 mistakes and I got a royal firing. So you can imagine writing 18,000 slokas. And what is the variety of scribes? Scribes those days could be illiterate. They would be employed by kings. And the king will say, okay, here is Bhagavatam, please translate. I mean, please, this thing, transcribe. A fellow doesn't know anything about Bhagavatam. He is looking at the shape of the thing, and he is copying. Now, have you seen small children reading? It will read like this, say the third line, and suddenly it is distracted. And then again it comes back, mommy says, no, study. It has stopped in the word play on the fifth line, and exactly down below on the eighth line, again that word play is there, it will start from there. It's common. Or it will read this line and it will skip one line and then read, a small child. It does not know what it is reading. Similarly, these scribes, they do not know what they are doing. So this is one variety of problem. The other variety is, you are giving Srimad Bhagavatam to somebody to transcribe. You got to pay him. So the job is payment basis. Olden days also payment hua hai. So when payment is in the equation, what happens? Which takes priority, speed or accuracy? So he finishes Bhagavatam, he gives it to the king. Here is Bhagavatam. Oh, wonderful. He'll take Bhagavatam, put it on the altar, worship it. And maybe 6 months, 12 months later, 2 years, 1 year later, he will start reading. There is a possibility he could find out that there is some mismatch. Or it could also be that there is a possibility he never finds out. Now the third variety of problem is that you are giving me something to write. I know the subject, but there is something to which I don't agree. Like Jayadev Goswami, I think so. He did not agree to a particular statement made by Krishna. I will protect what you have and provide what you... He was thinking, I am very insignificant. What will Krishna do? He wrote and then he struck it off and went to take bath. And then we all know what happened. So he did not agree with that. So you'll have these kind of people also doing the transcription. Now what happens is, this is a problem you will find especially with Mahabharata. And allow me to complete before you draw conclusions. Because now you all be thinking, ki ye bhaiya, ye sahi hai, nahi hai, what is it? Especially Mahabharata. Mahabharata, where was it recited? Any idea? I mean, quite popularly, it was recited in the courts of kings. King means he has his ministers and this and that. So the emphasis is political. Right? So Mahabharata, in fact, even Madhavacharya has said Mahabharata is corrupted. Corrupted does not mean that the content, that is the message coming out Mahabharata is corrupted. No, that is intact. Kuru's, Pandava's war, that is okay. But whether this, what we are holding as Mahabharata, is the actual Mahabharata, we don't know, because it has all undergone various interpretations. So, you will find the South Indian version of Mahabharata different from the North Indian version of Mahabharata, different from the Bengali version of Mahabharata, different from the Gujarati version of Mahabharata. Everybody will say Mahabharata written by Vedavyas. What do we do? I'll give you an example. And quite a lot of you may be knowing this pastime. Birth of Vedavyas. You all know how Vedavyasji was born? He was born to Parasar Muni and Satyavati. Parasar Muni was crossing the river. Satyavati was in charge of the boat. Parasar Muni fell in love with Satyavati. They had a Gandharva marriage. Marriage merely by consent. Thereafter, Satyavati was pregnant. Parasar Muni moved on. And Vedavyas was born thus. Now, in one section of Mahabharata, you will find this is how Vedavyas has been born, and they are saying, what? The author of all our scriptures, Vedas, Puranas, born this way? No way. He cannot be born in a Gandharva marriage. What they do is, Parasar Muni and Satyavati, they go to an island. The demigods all descend. They have a proper Vedic marriage. Then the deed is done. Then Parasar Muni moves on. Vedavyasa birth is proper. You will find both these versions in Mahabharata. Now, which one is right? This sort of a thing doesn't happen with Bhagavatam. And Bhagavad Gita also, in spite of the fact that Bhagavad Gita is part of Mahabharata. Why? That is why I said, just hold your thoughts. We should not be jumping to conclusion that this Bhagavatam is corrupted. No. And we'll see why it is not corrupted. Okay, before we see the why, let us build the suspense a little more. This is the reason why you will find Srila Prabhupada, supposing you take, normally what do we contend with? Bhagavad Gita and Bhagavatam. Do you find anywhere where Srila Prabhupada is quoting from Mahabharata? No. He will quote from Bhagavatam in Bhagavad Gita and from Bhagavad Gita in Bhagavatam. And this is the pattern by followed by the Acharyas also. Quotations from Mahabharata, very rare. Because we do not know whether it is right or wrong. Example, birth of Parikshit Maharaj. In Mahabharata, which is what they showed on the TV also, Parikshit Maharaj was born dead. He was a stillborn. And Krishna revived him back to life. It's in Mahabharata. That is, what does Bhagavatam say? Krishna never allowed him to die. Right? That is Bhagavatam. Kunti Maharani. We all know how pure Kunti Maharani is. Whereas in Bhagavatam, what is portrayed of her character? She tells one of the Pandavas, you get hold of 5 boys and 1 lady, we will burn them in that house so that it will show that yes, 5 children and the mother have died. Whereas do you think Kunti Maharani can ever dream of doing this, having this kind of a thought? Which Kunti Maharan do we relate to? Bhagavatam. Not Mahabharata. The Mahabharata, Kurus, Pandavas, this thing, all that is okay. But when it gets down to detail, we are on slippery ground. Now, coming back to this point as to why the words of Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita is, so to say, etched in stone. I mean, analysis had been done. That they took the Bhagavatam, this Bhagavatam, BBT version of Bhagavatam, and compared it with the critical version of Bhagavatam. And chapters after chapters, they hardly found a difference or two. Similarly with Bhagavad Gita, absolutely no difference. For instance, if I quote this Sarva Dharmam Parityajya verse, if I twist the word, 25 people from here will catch my throat, Baba, you have quoted it wrongly. Isn't it? This is what Bhagavad Gita and Bhagavatam has undergone, because Bhagavad Gita and Bhagavatam has been recited in a devotional environment right from beginning, and it has been held as a sacred scripture, so there is no iterations there. It is what was there from the beginning, it is the same thing. Carrying on. Right? So, this is it. Of course, there are one or two other issues also, but I think so we are getting late. So, have we seen something unique in today's class? We had a class on Bhagavatam. And anybody noticed what is unique here today? We have not discussed one verse or its meaning. So please see that slide. We have heard the structural aspects of Srimad Bhagavatam, and without discussing even one verse from the scripture, can we see how glorious it is? And it is appreciated all over. So Srimad Bhagavatam is the only hope. 1 minute. There is one last slide. If you can just, somebody can read this a little loud with a mic possibly, it would be helpful. Or I can read it. Or should I read it? Srila Prabhupada explains, this is purport to 3836. Maitreya's statement is that in order to avoid unchaste conscious activities, he was trying to describe the unlimited glories of the Lord. And although he did not have the ability to describe them perfectly. This glorification of the Lord is not a product of research, but the result of hearing submissively from the authority of the spiritual master. It is also not possible to repeat all that one has heard from his spiritual master, but one can narrate as far as possible by one's honest endeavor. It does not matter whether the Lord's glories are fully explained or not. One must attempt to engage one's bodily, mental, and verbal activities in the transcendental glorification of the Lord. Otherwise, such activities will remain unchaste and impure. The existence of the conditioned soul can be purified only by the method of engaging mind and speech in the service of the Lord, which is what we have all done today. So this subject matter is by no means complete. So if anybody else has any other perspective, most welcome. But then this is just chapter one in understanding the glories of Srimad Bhagavatam without studying one verse. The next one, if you all give me an opportunity, will be exclusively from Srimad Bhagavatam. What Bhagavatam has to say about itself, various verses. We will see about how the verses, they talk about Bhagavatam. In fact, and that pastime about Narada Muni giving a nudge to Vedavyas and all of that, it's pretty interesting. So thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Nitai Gaura Premanande, Hari Hari. Any questions or comments anybody may have?
Yes, Mataji. Can we have a mic? Or you can take this. Oh. All right. Oh, it's not cordless. Sorry? I also can't hear.
Hare Krishna. Prabhuji, thank you for the wonderful analysis of this subject. We have heard and read that Srimad Bhagavatam was actually written by Lord Ganesh with this tumali.
Yeah.
So how do you understand that?
Any of you all been to Badrinath? Yeah. Have you all had the opportunity to go and see Vyasa Gupha? Where is Vyasa Gupha located and where did Ganesha sit? Vyasadev narrated this entire thing and the order to Ganesha was that you hear, understand and write without interruption. And the difference, I mean, those days they did not have WhatsApp and internet and what have you. And I myself went there. It is mountainous territory, river Saraswati flowing in its full glory. Vyasadeva sitting quite on top. And Ganesha sitting in a cave in another place. So he dictated, he heard. He understood, he wrote it down. Yes, it was Ganesha who wrote Srimad Bhagavatam. Any other questions, Mataji? Yep.
Commentary. You mentioned Vidya Bhagavatam Avadhi,
yeah,
by Prabhupada, and where Lord Krishna says, Raja Vidya Raja Guhyam. Is the Bhagavad Gita is this Rajabidya, king of all.
Yeah.
So, I got confused, bro. Whether Rajabidya, that means king of all secret will be the supreme or... And whereas Prabhupada is saying this Avadhi, there's a limit here.
Yeah. Okay, let me explain. What Krishna is explaining is about the glories of Bhagavad Gita. That knowledge which is coming from Bhagavad Gita. Srila Prabhupada, when he mentions Vidya Bhagavatavadhi, he was talking about the literary connotations and being able to understand the Sanskrit verses inscribed in the Bhagavatam, the limit of understanding those Sanskrit verses. Avadhi, limit, is Bhagavatam. That is the language of Bhagavatam is very intricate. That is what he was. That is the Sanskrit language. Whereas in comparison, the Puranas, Ramayana, Mahabharata, easy Sanskrit. Whereas Bhagavatam, different paradigm altogether. We saw how tongue twisters, how many archaic languages, Vedic Sanskrit. This Vedic Sanskrit has not been used after the Upanishads. The Puranas, Ramayana, Mahabharata, everything is classical Sanskrit. And classical Sanskrit is easy to compose. So it is in reference to that Prabhupada mentioned Vidya Bhagavatavadhi.
So what we understand is basically Prabhupada is referring to this literally little part of that, yes. Not in the content aspect.
No.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Will you explain on that
I didn't quite get your question, sorry.
Yeah.
No, there are four authorized paramparas, and the parampara in which we have got this right from Prabhupada, from Chaitanya Mahaprabhu onwards, and going even behind to Brahmaji, etc. That is what is mentioned in the Bhagavad Gita. But it is only there. Could have been, I mean, I wouldn't know much about those, this thing. In fact, Krishna himself mentions in Bhagavad Gita that this knowledge I have been imparted to Vivaswan. And Bhagavad Gita itself has been lost. I mean, something mentioned by, narrated by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. That transmission itself has got lost. So, this is but natural. But then, Krishna, Prabhupada, etc., all the acharyas, they have come to give this back to us. That's what we need to take it from there. Yes, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna. Prabhuji, yes, thank you very much for this wonderful, enlightening analysis. I wanted to just add to what you said to her answer.
Yeah.
And then I had a question also.
Correct.
So, the parampara that is mentioned in Bhagavad Gita.
Yeah.
So see, in our line, the diksha is not given more importance. It is the siksha which is more important. So when Prabhupada is giving that lineage, it is a siksha lineage. But there could be diksha or guru also. So for example, Bhaktivinoda Thakur, spiritual master, directly is not Jagannath Babaji. But because the siksha connection is there, therefore, you know, it is mentioned like that. And in that Bhagavad Gita, only the prominent acharya's contribution, those who gave, that is mentioned. It is not completely mentioned. So it is only the prominent ones. That's just one thing.
Thank you very much, Prabhuji. Wonderful.
So Prabhuji, my question was that Srimad Bhagavatam is, as I understood, it is like the last Vedic literature that was compiled by Vyasadeva. Because
it is written in the maturity of his career.
Right. So, since Vyasadeva was actually worrying about, you know, the people who are coming in future.
Kali Yuga.
So, now that you explained that, you know, it is so technically so difficult, you know, to compose and all. The language is so amazing. So, I was like, I had a doubt that why would Vyasadeva compose a literature which is, you know, so difficult? If he is thinking about, you know, for future people who are going to be very, you know, manda sumanda. Like that.
Right. Incidentally, what Vyasadeva ji has done, pursuant to the nudge given by his spiritual master, Narad Muni, is to glorify the Srimad Bhagavatam. It is not that, like for instance, let me give you another example. We want to make suji halwa. So we go to the market, we buy suji, we buy sugar, I don't know what else it goes into that. The day we make suji halwa, it is not that is the first day suji halwa has been made. Suji halwa has already been existing. All we got to do is bring the various ingredients, make it into suji halwa. Similarly, Bhagavatam was already existent at that point in time. What Narad Muni provided the impetus was, look, you have taken quite a lot of austerity to write those Vedas, but you have given a wrong direction to the people to do these karmakandi efforts, etc., without making them realize what is the goal of life. So this was already existing. So the already existent recipe for suji halwa is what we will take. So it's not that Vyasadeva has, brought it out of his mind. In that sense, that it is presented fresh. It was already existing. So that question possibly has to be directed at Krishna. And someone was saying in Mayapur that, look, we could have various questions.
Some we will get answers, some we will not get answers. When our spiritual master takes us back home, back to Godhead, udhar mein sab answers milega. So I do not have the answer to that exact question which you asked. Any other thing? Yes, Prabhu.
A small reflection.
Yeah.
Going so deep into scriptures, when will one get a realization that knowledge itself is one of the detrimental factors in one's spiritual progress? And ultimately, search of knowledge will ultimately lead to paralysis by analysis.
Agreed. So, what is the thrust of your question? If you could,
yes,
you could
see,
rephrase that one thing.
Pursuit of knowledge is never ending.
Yeah.
New dimensions, new schools of thought, because what we consider as commentary could be refuted later. So ultimately, it is just about vad, vivad, and things like that. And over a period of time, we are trying to cow down some ideas, but it is not one's nature in the spiritual progress of a living entity. So the search for knowledge itself is going to be a detrimental factor in one's spiritual progress. So when does one get that realization? And okay, is it right to get such kind of a realization?
Can I ask you a counter question? What is knowledge which you are referring to?
I don't know.
I don't know. Okay, there are two kinds of knowledge. One is spiritual empirical knowledge. The other is mundane knowledge. Now, if it is mundane knowledge, like when I was studying in my school, those days Pluto was a planet. 25 years later, I read somewhere that Pluto is no longer a planet. Science is evolving. Bhagavad Gita Bhagavatam is not evolving. It is etched in stone. What Krishna has given millions of years ago, it is still there. Now, if you talk about the commentaries. See, nobody is tattvavit as far as any particular branch of knowledge goes. I am talking of spiritual knowledge. All we will get is a perspective. But what has been mentioned in Bhagavatam especially is pibata bhagavatam rasamalayam. Any perspective you take, that is full of rasa, provided it is spiritual knowledge. When it comes to material knowledge, all bets are off. We don't know where we are. So to answer your question, Prabhu, it all depends as to what is the kind of a knowledge which we seek. Spiritual knowledge, it is embedded in stone. Material knowledge, not so much. I don't know whether that answers your question, but...
No, just
yeah, reflection.
As they themselves have mentioned, all these itihasas, puranas and all these things, the evolution of philosophy and all such things,
yeah,
he had to cater to various different segments of the society.
That's right.
Not
that's
all
right.
Of them are knowledgeably evolved, so he has to cater to everybody. So
Buddha, when he came about on the scene, he saw people were killing animals. So his first priority was to stop that. So he gave them a course of literature, which thereafter was modified by Shankaracharya. Thereafter, we have got what we have got today from Prabhupada. So it is not that knowledge is incorrect. That knowledge was correct or appropriate for that time period. Thereafter, we have evolved, so we get a different kind of a knowledge. That's it. Yes, Prabhupada.
Same thing. If you are materially oriented and look into spirituality, then what he says is incomplete. Because you are speculating and trying to understand the philosophy. But if you are coming through the parampara, you don't have that.
That's right. That leeway. And we saw why it is important to study all these scriptures in parampara. So... Shall we close?
Yes.
Srimad Bhagavatam Grantharaj ki jai, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Nitai Gaura Premanande, Hari Hari Bol.